Today I will go through Arch Linux installation process. I will install it on my Proxmox server, but you should find this video useful even if you want to install it on any other device, like maybe your laptop, maybe directly on your PC, or maybe even bare metal server you have somewhere. So first, we need the Arch Linux ISO image. I will simply Google something like Arch Linux download. And I will choose that first link, Arch Linux downloads. Here is where we can download the ISO images, and you can see that ISO image can be burned to a DVD. I don't think anybody does it anymore, but it can be also mounted as ISO file, that's what we will do in our Proxmox server, and can also be directly written to a USB flash drive. That's what you might want to do if you install it on a laptop or PC, and not on Proxmox server. But anyways, we scroll down, and there are some locations, I mean. So you can pick the location that is quite close to you. Will be at the very bottom, I guess. So for me, maybe I will pick bitemark.co.uk, let's say. And what you need is that very top link. It's just .iso image. You can see it's 1.1 gig, so we just click on that link. And it starts downloading. And now the download is completed. Again, if you want to install that Arch Linux on laptop or PC, you can use a program like Balena Etcher or any other program that is able to create bootable USB drive from that ISO image, and then just stick that USB to your laptop or PC and boot from that USB image. But because we are installing it on Proxmox server, the process is a little bit different. So we go to Proxmox server. You can see I have some already running, CasaOS and Ubuntu. But we go to local PVE, and this is where we upload the ISO we've just downloaded. So I just click that upload button, and I will select the file that has just been downloaded. It's this one, in downloads, Arch Linux. I will select it, and just click upload. You can see task OK, that's what you always want to see, really. So we can close it, and now in that local PVE in ISO images, you can see we have Arch Linux available. So we are ready to create a VM. I will just click on that, create VM. I will pick the ID for that VM. Maybe I will change it to 205, because I've got 204 already for Ubuntu. And CasaOS was installed different way, that's why it's so low. But I usually pick numbers above 200. I will name it Arch Linux. And we can go next to the OS. In OS, we just have to pick the image we've just uploaded to the Proxmox. The type can be left as it is, so we just click next. Here, I usually click QEMU agent, but I haven't figured out if it's useful for Arch Linux yet. So basically, you can also leave it as it is and just click next. Disks, I believe 2 gig is minimum for Arch Linux. But I will give it some extra space. I will give it maybe 20 gig. That should be plenty. And I will add discard, which is the trim option for SSD, and SSD emulation, leaving everything else as it is. So then I click next. CPU. CPU, I think I talked about it. I always use type host, which is here at the very bottom. So host basically disables emulation. And if you want to read more about it, in this help button, if you click it, you will see that if you don't care about live migrations, you can set your CPU to host, and it should give you maximum performance. That's why I always choose it. So it's actually it's a lot of useful information here. You can read it all, not only about the CPU type. But never mind, let's go back to our installation. I will give it more cores, maybe two. And what I usually pick here as well is allow host to use page size pages. Sorry, that's what I usually enable. And I believe that's all. That should be fine. So I can click next. Memory. I use balloning, which means it's like a floating amount of RAM. By the way, if you can't see it, you probably don't have that advanced button clicked. So yeah, maybe minimum we will set it to 1024 and maximum to 2048. Something like that. Should be more than enough. Then next. Network. I don't really want to change anything. For me, it's good as it is. So I just click next. And this is just confirmation, you can go through and see if, yeah, that's really what I want to configure. So we just click finish, and our VM will start already here, 205. You can see the Arch Linux. So what we can do now, just click on it, and either click the right button of the mouse and start it here, or we can start it there as well. So we start, And then we can also console to that instance. You will see this is the installation guide, and it will automatically start in 7 seconds anyway. We can actually check other options, but usually the top one is what you go for. So I click enter and we start the installation process. And it will stop at this stage. So why it stopped here? It actually says above. You can see it will require connection to the internet. So if you are connected to wireless, for example, if this is your laptop, if you are installing it on your laptop and you use wireless connection, you will have to use that IWCTL utility because you need that device to be connected to internet. Arch Linux will require that connection for the installation process. So you would type something like IWCTL, then the dash dash passphrase, then here, in quotes, I believe, it would be your password. I mean, you shouldn't type your password. You should type actually what your password is for your Wi-Fi connection. Hope that makes sense. And then station, usually it's WLAN 0, and then connect. And here is where you type your Wi-Fi SSID. So whatever it's called, I don't know, maybe my home network or whatever. But because my Proxmox server doesn't have even Wi-Fi card, it uses a wired connection, so I can ignore that step entirely because it's only needed when you are on Wi-Fi. And remember, even if you have laptop or PC that is currently on Wi-Fi, you might still temporarily even connect it with the Ethernet cable only for the installation process, so you don't have to play with that IWCTL command at all. So it's up to you. In my case, I can now either just type arch install to run installation configuration script, or I can do it old-fashioned way and configure every single setting manually. But the Arch install installation script is much more user-friendly, so let's just use that. We type Arch install and just press enter. So you get that configuration guide, let's call it, where we can choose all the settings that we are interested in. Arch install language English, yes, that's fine, we can leave it. Mirrors, if we click enter, you can see mirror region. If we click enter again, it will give you all the regions available, but you should simply pick one close to where you live. And you can see at the bottom here, press forward slash to search. So if I press forward slash and then you and I've got United Kingdom, United States or Reunion. For me, it's United Kingdom and I can press tab button to select it. You can see that little asterisk shows up. So I press tab again to deselect and tab to select. Press enter and we can go back. Now the next option, localis, that's actually like keyboard and language settings. So if you are in US, you are probably okay. You probably don't have to change anything because you can see down here below info, keyboard layout is already set to US. Language is ENUS, so English US. And encoding is UTF-8, which is probably okay for you. But for me, I will change it because what I need is UK, which is here, just above US. The language I want is EN, but it's ENGB. And the encoding, yes, it's okay, UTF-8. So we can go back. We are in the main menu, but note that if I go up again to localis, we'll now see all those settings that I currently picked. If I go even further up, my region was United Kingdom, keyboard layout is UK, etc. So let's go further, disk configuration. Let's click enter. And you can pick here manual partitioning if you wish and go through that fdisk config, etc. Partition it, the disk, you know, any way you want. But you know what? If you use the best effort default partition, it's so much easier. I will show you. You just click enter here, and then you pick the volume we've just created for that operating system in Proxmox, which is this QEMU hard disk. So again, I will press tab to select it. The little asterisk showed up, and I press enter. Now we can pick our file system, and honestly, I don't know if you want to use XFS or F2FS. Probably the choice is between Extended 4 and BetterFS. And because BetterFS is a newer file system, so maybe I want to select that setting. I will click enter. It will ask me if I want to create subvolumes with a default structure. Yes, that's what I want. And it will ask if you want to use compression. So I will pick that as well. So again, with up arrow, you can see all the information, what we've just configured. It will create small FAT32 volume just for boot, and then the BetterFS as main storage. And that's fine. Next option is disk encryption, and if I click enter and then enter again encryption password, you can see enter disk encryption password or leave blank for no encryption. For me, I don't want to encrypt the disk, but maybe you want. Basically, if you leave it blank, there will be no encryption. If you use the password here, your disk will be encrypted. That's all it is. Let's go back. Now the bootloader, the group is selected for me and it's fine, but if I wanted, I can change to different one. But let's stick to group. Swap, true, and yes, that's what I want to leave. I want to use swap. Hostname, you can change it if you want. You know, it's you can call it whatever you want. No, I will just leave it. Doesn't really matter. Now the root password. If we click enter, it says enter root password. Leave blank to disable root. And again, it's up to you. But I personally, I would just disable root. Because in the next step, we will be able to create a user with sudo access. And many new Linux versions have root account disabled. By default, I mean. So it's your choice. If you type the password here, you will have root account. If you just leave it blank, you disable the root. And that's what I will do. I will disable the root. I will not type anything here. And now we have user account. User account, add a user. I will create a new user. I will call it Marek. Password. Okay, I have to type it again for verification. And now it asks me, should Marek be a super user? Well, yes. Remember, I don't have root account. So yes, I want to have a user with super user privileges. So I click enter. Yes. And that's it. And if I want, I can add another user. I can create as many users as you want, but that one is fine for me. I will just confirm and exit. And now the profile. Let's click enter to get into that. And the type, click enter again. And this is interesting one, because you can choose like minimal server or Xorg, but I would go personally for desktop, because you can see it installs like Vim, HTOP, etc., but it also prepares your desktop environment. If you want to have that graphical user interface, the desktop profile is really the one you want to go for. So I will click enter. And now it asks me which ones I want to select. Most people will be familiar, just like me, with GNOME or KDE. And you use tab again to select your choice. But note that you can actually select more than one. You can select all of them even if you want. And then you can switch between them. But to keep things simple, I will just use GNOME and that's it. So I click enter. Now it asks me for a graphic driver. And by default, it's all open source. And this setting is okay for Proxmox, but let's click enter anyways. So if you install this Arch Linux on your laptop or PC, maybe you have AMD, Intel or Nvidia card, and do you want to install different drivers, then this is the, you know, the way to do that. But as I said, Proxmox is okay with the open source only. And we also have Gritter. Gritter is just your login page. If we click enter here, the only other one I heard is SDDM, but GDM is fine as well. It's just a login page, so it's not that important really. Okay, so we can go back, arrow up, you can see, you can review it again, arrow down, next option is audio. And by default, it's no audio server. Well, you don't want to really leave it as that. Let's click enter, and you've got two options really, Pipewire or Pulse Audio. And I would go for Pipewire, because it's newer option with real-time multimedia processing and some other advantages. But you might consider Pulse Audio only if you find some issues with the Pipewire. For me it works great, so I will pick Pipewire. Now the kernels. By default, it's a default Linux kernel, but if we click enter, you can see we've got other kernels as well. There is a hardened one and there is a long-time support. And the thing is, if you click tab, you will note you can select more than one. And you know what, it's not that stupid, because maybe you want to play with that later on and booting your Linux using different versions of kernel. But for this scenario, I will just use basic one, the default one, I mean. Enter additional packages. Let's click enter maybe. It says that, you know, you can install additional stuff in the installation process. The truth is, you can do it later on as well. But it says, you know, if you desire a web browser such as Firefox or Chromium, you might specify it here in following prompt. Well, you know what, why not? I mean, I will probably need both, so I can type Firefox and Chromium. Just as it says, it have to be space separated. So it's not comma separated, it's space separation. And just click enter. It will verify at the same time. Have a look. Yes, they are listed. If you had error on previous stage, that means you probably misspelled something or the package is called something different. We can go now to network configuration. Let's click enter. And I guess 9 out of 10 times you will just go for network manager. But if you want, you can also configure it manually here. If I click enter on manual configuration, it will ask me to add interfaces. It will see I have it connected with Ethernet cable. The interface is ENS18. Then I click enter and I can choose if it should be DHCP, dynamic host configuration protocol, or static IP. If I want static, I can create static IP here. So for me, something like 192.168.1, maybe what, 205/24. And default gateway is the IP of my router, which is 192.168.1.1. DNS, maybe Cloudflare 1111. And you can confirm and exit. But I will actually cancel because I will go back and I will just use that network manager. So, you know, let me go back again, but you can see how much easier it is. Just use network manager rather than typing everything manually. But it's your choice again. Time zone. Loads and loads of time zones. You can scroll down, but it's much easier to press forward slash again to search as suggested. So I will forward slash to London and I've got Europe London time zone. That's what I need. Automatic time sync. I would always leave it true. You want to use NTP for various reasons. Optional repositories. I'm not interested. So I can simply install it now. Let's click enter. Again, enter. It says press enter to continue. Will formatting the drive, it will follow with the installation process, and once it's done, we should have running Arch Linux. Okay, this took a while, probably several minutes, but it now asks us, would you like to shroot or chroot into the newly created installation and perform some post-installation configuration? Well, no, that's not what I'm interested in, so I will just pick no, click enter, and it will reboot. Oh, sorry, it will not reboot on its own. You have to type reboot. So, enter, and the Arch Linux should be now up and running. We can pick first option, Arch Linux. And that's it. Now we can log in. By the way, this is that GDM, remember? It's called Greeter in Arch Linux. So I can type my password. And that's our Arch Linux installed. You can take the tour. I will just skip it. And you can see those 9 dots. You can see the Firefox, for example, and Chromium has been installed because we added it as additional packages. We've got already Vim installed and some other stuff like HTOP. You can also type here, let's say terminal. If you want, you can make this window bigger. You can also type HTOP here to see the CPU utilization, memory utilization, and all the nice stuff. If I want to open Firefox, I can use this, go there again, and Firefox. Okay, that's it. I hope that's helpful. So, see you next time.